5 years ago by Donald Curry, when Curry was a truly outstanding fighter. To survive that kind of a car wreck is sort of like surviving a real car wreck, and you don't come back from a real car wreck and drive the way you used to, any more than you come back from that kind of a whipping and fight the way you used to. Except that Marlon Starling has, and now he's in his fourth title fight in a year. He's appealing for other reasons, too.
The day-in, day-out life of a fighter is anything but glamorous. It's a sport that demands hard work, patience, years of intense training, and above all, self-discipline. For Marlon Starling, the reward for his years of perseverance came on August 22, 1987, when he knocked out Mark Breland to become the WBA welterweight champion. But what Marlon Starling is most proud of is not the victories in the ring or the years of overcoming pain and frustration on the way to a world championship. Starling's greatest pleasure takes place away from the world of boxing. Like 1 million other men in the United States, Marlon Starling is a single parent. Having fathered a child out of wedlock, Starling has assumed all responsibilities in raising his 11-year-old son, Marlon Jr.
We have a good relationship. You know, growing up, he was my little kid. Today, he's my best friend. You know, I think being a single parent is tougher than being a professional fighter. I think anybody can put on a pair of gloves and fight, but it takes a great person to be a good dad.
Dividing his time between training camps and fights has kept Starling away from his son more than he'd like. He realizes that as long as he remains a fighter, he'll never have a 9-to-5 schedule. And that has taught him the difference between quantity and quality time.
I know that Marlon is being brought up the right way, I believe. I try to teach him, first of all, to be a good person. He knows right from wrong. He knows what he should do and what he shouldn't do. I mean, it's tough. Believe me, kids are challenging, and they're challenging every single day. That's a job that can never be taught, and you can never know all the way if you're doing the right thing or not.
Playing the roles of father, mother, and fighter, Marlon Starling has been a positive model for Marlon Jr. Even having his young son with him at training camp has not been overwhelming or distracting to the champion. In fact, he'd have it no other way.
Our relationship is buddy-buddy. Having him up here for me right now, this time in my training, is not only helping me prepare myself, it's helping him, because he has to prepare for summer school. So we prepare reading together. So really, it's my job. I'm supposed to be getting ready for a world title fight, and I'm reading little books with him. But that makes, you know, it makes my job easier. That's why I say he helps me as much as I help him.
I believe the children are our future. Teach them well and let them lead the way. Show them all the beauty they possess inside. A sense of pride to make it easier. Let the children's laughter remind us how we used to be. Everybody's searching for a hero. People need someone to look up to.
I think being a single parent made me say to myself, thank God for mothers. You know, regardless of which way this bout turns out tonight or which way any bout turns out, Marlon's gonna be there. Now, he'll take me if I win by a knockout. If I get knocked out, Marlon's gonna love me regardless. So that's my title. That's my championship goal, is to be a championship father.
And tonight, if he is to retain that championship, here is the man he must beat. Tomas Molinares now lives in Cartagena, Colombia, has won 22 fights without a loss, 19 of them knockouts. Earlier this evening, we saw a young man named Rafael Pineda, lightweight, who is from the same stable of fighters in Colombia as Molinares, and he opened a lot of eyes around here in a spectacular performance. If Molinares is as good as was Pineda, then Starling may have quite a tough assignment tonight.
Well, what that fight told us, if we needed any reminding, is that there's a rich tradition of boxing in Colombia. And even though Molinares hasn't been seen much out of Colombia, it doesn't mean that his unbeaten record is meaningless. That young fighter, Pineda, fought a very sophisticated fight, so you know there's a strong subculture of trainers and managers and whatnot in Colombia. In fact, they have two champions of the world right now, a flyweight and a bantamweight. So I wouldn't be surprised if Molinares could truly fight.
And in addition to being an interesting cultural matchup, it could be an interesting tactical matchup, too. Here's Ray Leonard's tip of the night.
Well, Jim, in viewing the tall and rangy Molinares, you know that he has a nice, consistent left jab. He's used that left jab to maintain Stalin in the center of the ring. And that ducking style that Stalin has, the uppercut, will prove to be a fatal weapon. If that doesn't work, I suggest Molinares turns into a street fight. Just go for it. Go for broke, and hopefully you get lucky. Talk about defense. Stalin has very good defense, very unorthodox. Keeps those hands very, very high, the peekaboo style, and then he retaliates. But what he should do with Molinares, keep that jab out there until he is able to find an opening. He can't get too careless because that could prove to be fatal. Inside, work the body, and just try to slow his man down. But stay very, very cautious.
And just now entering the ring, Ray, is 29-year-old Marlon Starling of Hartford, Connecticut. He's not just the father of the little boy, but there's a lot of the little boy in Marlon, in the joy and excitement that he brings to life. He has become a champion the hard way, as we look at his record, Larry.
Yes, he has, and that's the good way very often, because he's paid his dues. He's fought just about every top-ranked welterweight around over the last 6-7 years. He's a true, real professional fighter and a good one.
Tale of the tape, and you will see that, just as Ray Leonard suggested, Molinares is somewhat the rangier fighter, at least in height. Starling, 29 years old, and they both weighed in right at the welterweight limit.
However, Molinares, I was told by some Colombian writers, had to take off as much as 20 pounds over the last month. He's normally fought at around 150, 152 pounds. In a long, tough fight, that could be telling. But when a fighter is as young and eager as this kid, it may not mean anything.
Rules for the fight combine the New Jersey rules with the WBA rules. Three knockdown rule is in effect here. 10-point must system, three judges scoring it again. Here in New Jersey, you cannot be saved by the bell in any round, even the last one. Now for the official intros, let's go to Michael Buffer.
Once again, ladies and gentlemen, this bout is presented by Mr. Donald Trump's Trump Plaza Hotel and Casino and Main Event Monitor Productions in association with Cedric Kushner Productions. It is sanctioned by the New Jersey State Athletic Control Board, Boxing Commissioner Larry Hazard, and the World Boxing Association, the ringside supervisor from El Salvador, Santiago Chicas. All the other officials shall remain the same, but the three judges doing the scoring on the 10-point must system will be Guy Jutra from Canada, Bernie Soto from Florida, and Ove Ovesen from Denmark. And now, ladies and gentlemen, let's get ready to rumble. 12 rounds for the WBA Welterweight Championship of the World. The referee for this bout is Joe Cortez from the United States. Introducing first, fighting out of the red corner. He's wearing the black trunks with red and yellow trim, and he weighs 146¾ pounds. Undefeated as a professional with 22 consecutive victories, 19 by knockout. Ladies and gentlemen, from Barranquilla, Colombia, the number one ranked WBA welterweight contender in the world, Tomas Molinares. And introducing in the blue corner, wearing the red trunks with white trim, he weighs an even 147 pounds as a professional. 43 victories against 4 defeats and 1 draw, 26 by KO. From Hartford, Connecticut, introducing the WBA welterweight champion of the world, Marlon Magic Man Starling.
dressing room, usted y las reglas ya en el camerino. Okay, I want a good clean fight and protect yourself at all times. Okay, protect them, la mano, suelte a los dos. Good luck. Daddy has a word to talk to you.
I think what Starling wants to do and may have to do is to let this kid know right from the get-go that he's in with something tough, that he's in another level of competition, so that his confidence can't be built up. Because right now he's young and unbeaten and full of confidence.
First blow of the bout is a right-hand lead by Molinares. Now Starling sets up in the peekaboo stance.
Boxing from Molinares than I've seen in his films and watching him. He scores direct, he's straight up, which allows Starling to throw his combinations and land them.
These jabs by Molinares are being picked off by Starling. Within the past year, Marlon has been working with Eddie Futch, and that has only served to enhance his already considerable defensive skills.
Well, working with having Futch in your corner is always a plus for you, because he'll show you things that you normally have forgotten, not using. And here with Starling, Starling doesn't use, is not using his jab like he should be. He needs to use his jab a little bit more to get a little closer. Here he's rushing himself.
Neither fighter has landed a significant blow so far in round one. Beginning to step up a little closer now to try to get some range for the jab.
It's not easy to penetrate the defense of Marlon Starling. He keeps those hands very high, peekaboo style.
Starling's jab is beginning to find its mark.
Well, see here, what you see in Molinares, he's just moving around, not really throwing a lot of punches. And the punches that he is throwing, they're straight punches landing on the elbows of Starling. The way to get around that, throw a body shot. You know, there he threw a body shot. Go around those punches. Work on the midsection, the liver shots. I'm watching now as Starling goes in with Stamps, goes in with his head down. The uppercut of Molinares will be very, very effective.
He hasn't thrown it yet. And now Molinares begins to try to go downstairs, just as you suggested.
Peeling out around both fighters.
Keep that jab going. Single and double. Don't let him walk to you. See? Keep them going back. When he goes down underneath, I don't just send him straight to punch. I want you to get down low. And don't try to go with the bomb. Get on the target. With the first and second shots, and the third shot will be the big shot, okay?
Okay.
All right.
Have fun, baby.
Don't let him throw too many punches before you counter back.
Okay.
Okay.
Come on, control, control.
Faint and sticking, faint and sticking.
What I noticed in that round, Ray, is that Starling, who frequently is a manic kind of fighter and uses and sometimes wastes a lot of energy, was patient there, and that may be a sign of Futch's handling.
He sold the experience and also the patience. Patience is a virtue, as they say. And he has to be patient against a guy, a young kid like this, Molinares, who's very, very aggressive and very cocky.
Starling expended a lot of energy in the early rounds of his April 16 defense against Mark Freeland, when many thought he had weakened in the late rounds en route to the draw. Some of us at ringside didn't believe that bout should have been scored as a draw.
Eddie Fudge in Starless Corner also indicated not to let Molinaris get his punches off. Don't stand there and take punches and then come back. You be first. You initiate the tempo of the fight.
And it looks as though Molinaris has gotten the same instruction, Ray, as he becomes a little more aggressive.
Part of the instructions given by Fudge, not for Stallings to stand straight up.
Both fighters significantly more aggressive in round two.
Well,
that's the third right-hand lead he's managed to land in the round. Something that Starling's last opponent, Mark Breland, virtually never tried. Uppercut by Molinaris.
Starling told me he watched the tape of Molinaris maybe once or twice. And he always, Molinaris looked the same. But here, I'm sure he's seen a different picture. Molinaris.
Molinaris is beginning to show real variety in his punch selection here and is able to step up inside and control Starling in these exchanges.
I like the way Molinaris is moving. He's not being a stationary target. He's using the ring. He's faint. Good upper body movement. Come with the right hand. Straight right hand. There's the right hand again.
Slows Molinaris down.
Molinaris has a tendency to telegraph his right hand. Watch when he throws his jab, how he brings his right hand back and then throws it.
He also drops the left on that right hand lead. Good left hand after the bell by Molinaris. Starling went back after him. And that was dangerous.
This one, listen to what I'm going to say. You have to do it stronger. Stronger. How do you feel? Strong? Listen, when he's working, don't let him think. Don't let him think. Come into him. Stronger. Jab, jab, and right. Clear? You don't have any respect for him.
In ringside, a gentleman that just came in, he is a former Olympic champion, a former undisputed,
champion,
a gentleman and classy man, Mr. Michael Spinks, ladies and gentlemen.
The champion. Now let's see if he becomes more aggressive and positive as his trainer implored him to be.
That trainer, Amilcar Bruza, used to train a fighter named Rodrigo Valdez. You may remember from bouts in the early 70s.
Very good middleweight champion.
Now we see Stalin really trying to manhandle Molinaris, trying to load up with one big punch.
Toying with each other right now.
Well, who's coming? is a little frustrated here.
Good left hand by Starling. And another one. He begins to find the range now with the left hook.
Shots being landed by either fighter.
And Molinar is not quite as quick in this round, Ray, as he was in round two.
Well, at least he's landing punches. The thing about it, he's throwing his jab, and they do count his points.
Right hand, three in a row to the glove of Starling, but they were glancing off the glove and onto the sole.
It almost appears, Jimmy, that Starling's trying to make Molinar wear himself out. Throw all his punches, exert himself, and then he come on strong.
Starling landed the counter right. Molinar says, wait a minute. I'm going to reestablish command here. But more and more, Molinar is dropping the right hand and allowing Marlon to land that left hook.
Okay. He's a front champ. He's a front champ. Yeah, that's just got all that confidence.
No.
See, now, when he does what he did on the rope, throw to the body. Forget the head. He wants you to punch to the head.
Okay.
Understand that? And you're not punching nearly enough to the body. Okay. I want you to dig in there.
Okay.
With both hands. Okay? All right.
That's deep breath.
Look at this guy here.
But you let it punch too much.
How have you scored the fight?
Coming back
I've got it two rounds to one, 29 to 28 in favor of Mucci Starling. I gave him rounds one and three. I gave the second round to Thomas Molinaris based on the good right hands he landed. But, you know, let me tell you something. We score for clean punching, effective aggressiveness, ring generalship, and defense. And in Starling's case, you have to take defense into consideration considerably because he's a good defensive fighter. He catches that jab every time.
I've scored the fight the same way, but one thing we know, it's a fight.
And a pretty good one as round four begins.
What I like about it, Ray, is it's boxing at close quarters. Neither man is running. They're both probing, looking for weaknesses, trying to force openings.
Well, the plus that they have, Lars, is the upper body movement. In fact, Starling complimented, good combination, he complimented Paul Norris on his upper body movement. If anything, he was impressed by that.
One thing which may begin to befuddle Molinaris over a period of time is the gradual discovery of how strong Starling's chin is. This man has taken many of the best punches which could have been dished out in the welterweight division, and he hasn't been down.
Well, the key is maintaining this pace. More so for Molinaris because he is the younger of the two, less experienced of the two. And once Starling takes him to the deep waters into the later round, he may see a difference. But here, Molinaris is holding his own.
By Starling landed. Going back to the jab, which was effective in round one. And scoring with it. Molinaris beginning to stagger just a little bit, losing some of the resiliency in his legs. Good right hand inside off the combination by Starling.
Remember, Ray, when Fudge said the third one would land, that's exactly what happened in that combination.
Because he's not just loading up with one punch, he's throwing in combinations. Too many many times fighters make the mistake of trying to load with one punch. You got to throw a combination. Good cover right hand by Stalling.
And the left that followed. Molinares comes right back with the right. But Mucci is blocking most of these punches now with his gloves.
Watch the leadoff right by Stalling. Give a little feint and drops the right hand. There it is. There it is again.
Established in that round that he was the boss. We'll see if he can sustain it.
Don't throw the water like that. Thomas, you got to hit him harder. Back up and then come back to him. When he is standing, come to him. When he's coming at you, then back up one step and then come back to him. Listen. When he's coming to you, back up one step and then come back to him.
This may be a crucial round for Molinares. He's got to somehow establish the fact that he's not being dominated. Because if he's dominated, not only does the Stalling know it, but the officials start to feel it. And if it's a close round, the officials will give it to Stalling. He must come back and establish something in this round, otherwise find himself well behind in a lot of different ways.
And you heard Brusa telling him to gain power by stepping back and then coming forward at Stalling. That will give Stalling the chance to keep backing him up if Marlon wants to be aggressive and go forward.
I'm watching the wave as Stalling's peppering this man with a jab, beat up right hand. In fact, Molinares talked to him. I asked him whether or not he's been knocked down. He said no, but he's been cut. But he would not disclose where he was cut. And that jab is really, really frustrating and aggravating Molinares.
Beginning to step in and throw him around the ring a little bit. Good right hand inside by Stalling, the left as he stepped away. A lot of these punches are landing. Stalling, meanwhile, continues to block most of what Molinares is now throwing with his arms, his elbows, and his gloves.
Molinares appears to be wearing down just a little here, a little less steam on his punches. Here are signs of desperation throwing those looping right hands.
Yeah, the right hand is swinging now.
Champion that knows exactly what needs to be done and he wants to do it now.
There's a lot of swelling now around the right eye of Molinares. Stalling loves to combine the body shots with a looping overhand right. Doesn't need it as Molinares' his guard is dropping and Marlon is able to just hit him with straight right hand. Look at how low Molinares' hands are going.
It must be frustrating, Ray, that when a fighter is throwing so many punches and they're almost all being blocked.
Punches too, Larry. It's just a matter of time here. He's starting to wear his man down. Stalling now is showing the experience that he has, working the body, throwing combinations, punching with both hands.
And becoming more dominant with each passing round.
Oh, he buckled Molinares just a second there.
This is a brilliant exhibition of boxing by Marlon Stalling right here in round five.
On, bang that body some more, keep those combinations coming, three and four punch combinations instead of one. Remember, when you get down
earlier we talked about three punch combinations. There you see three that land. Take a look from another angle. A fighter is happy to throw three punches and get one good one in. He got three good ones in.
Hazlo de costado cuando está ahí al lado suyo.
Meta de corazón.
When it comes to you, let him go on the side. Don't let him come directly to you. Let him go on the side and hit him harder. Don't wait to hit him.
Our punch stat colleagues tell me that in the last round they counted 70 attempted punches by Molinaris and he landed only 8.
This could be the beginning of the end. Jim, the reason I say this is because Stalin was able to hurt his man in that 5th round. And I don't see as much confidence in Molinari's face as we had, as we did early, in the earlier rounds, brother. Stalin's putting a lot of body behind his punches.
Well, 2 rounds ago, you heard Brusa telling Molinaris to back up and then come forward. He's doing the backing up half. All of those punches were blocked.
You just see the maturity in Stalin. He's so much stronger than Molinaris. Just started to pick his man apart.
Chosen opponent for Mark Breland in Columbia, South Carolina.
Breland, another of those young, up-and-coming colts whom Starling has taken care of in his career. He administered the only defeat on Simon Brown.
Watch what happens here, as he retells. Starling lets this man throw his punches, and then he comes off with a series of combinations. Doing is throwing his combination. Not all those punches are not really hard. He wants the 3rd or 4th punch to have an impact. Just trying to get a feel for his bangs. See? The second combination, he throws 1 or 2, then 3 or 4 combinations.
Brilliant stuff. We've seldom seen him better.
Counter right hand by Starling. Starling really picking shots now. Looking for the target. That's when a man picks his shots.
And Molinaris is arm weary but won't stop throwing punches.
Now the uppercut to Starling would be great because you see how there's the uppercut. Because Molinaris is chin, he's leaning to the punches.
Another punch for him, Ray.
Watch the right hand. But most of the uppercuts, those are the type of punches that raise the chin of his opponent for the left hook.
Oh! That punch was clearly after the bell, and Starling is being counted out. 8, 9, 10. At the time it landed. I could be proven wrong here, but let's see.
Larry, Caesar. Let me go up in the ring and check.
So Larry Merchant goes into the ring. You look at Tomas Molinaris, the fighter who is still standing. Marlon Starling is still on a stool in the neutral corner just in front of us. This is one of the most star-crossed careers in boxing. An uphill fight all the way. And right now it appears that Marlon Starling may have been victimized by a terrible bad break.
Sympathy for Marlon Starling, but hopefully we get another shot at that knockout. And here both guys throwing punches. Starling's inside. Molinari's throwing his punches. Can't really hear the bell because of the crowd.
There you heard it. Heard the bell. Saw the punch launch clearly after the bell. There had been other punches after the bell earlier in the fight. We look at it again, Ray, and let's stay out and be quiet. Just seen one. Larry Merchant is standing in the center of the ring with referee Joe Cortez. And I'm going to throw to Larry right now. I don't know if we can get a camera shot, but Larry, you go.
All right. I'm with referee Joe Cortez. Joe, how did you see the punch?
Well, the punch was, the punch was in motion at the bell. Molinari threw the punch. As it was, the real bell was ringing, the punch was already in action. And he just banged him and tagged him. I have to count.
What would you say if we showed you a replay and it showed that the punch was launched after the bell?
Well, I tell you, I'm human. I saw the punch as they were already in progress when the bell rang. The punch is already in progress, and he got tagged.
Thank you very much, Joe. Just one thing. I do want to tell you that Marlon Starling's handlers have stated that they will protest this fight. Jim?
Thank you very much, Larry Merchant, and obviously we'll await further interviews from there in the ring as we attempt to explore this situation more fully. Marlon Starling is having the bottom part of his leg wrapped and taped. Apparently he suffered an injury. I don't know whether that occurred as he fell from the punch or perhaps as the melee broke out in the ring following the fight, Ray, because there were literally hundreds of people who were trying to get into the ring. And right now, through interpreter Tito Alba, Larry Merchant will chat with Tomas Molinaris. Larry?
Tomas Molinaris. Tomas, would you explain what happened from your point of view?
Quiero explicar desde tu punto de vista qué fue lo que pasó. Bueno, la verdad que al principio nos estábamos un poco controlando por las manos, pero en ningún momento perdí la calma porque yo tenía las palabras más que todo en mi cabruza. Imagínate, un mes y medio insistiendo lo mismo, la misma cintura, y que tenía que ser la mano derecha poderosa. Al fin todo salió bien.
At the beginning I was a little bit out of control, but as the fight went on, I got more confidence because of my manager and my trainers telling me what to do, and I was trying to follow exactly what they were telling me to do.
There's some dispute about whether the punch was thrown at the bell or after the bell. How did he see it or hear it?
Se dice que el golpe se lo diste antes de la campana o después de la campana. ¿Cuál es tu opinión?
Antes de la campana.
Before the bell.
Thank you very much, Tomas. And now back again to Jim and Ray.
And Larry, right now, to add to the freakishness of this situation, Marlon Starling is having a broken leg wrapped. We do not yet know how Marlon Starling sustained a broken leg, but a stretcher has been brought into the ring. His leg is being wrapped and set by doctors at this moment as Eddie Futch holds the hand of his fighter. And with a broken leg, Marlon Starling is prepared to exit the ring. And you hear him saying, I'm not going to go out on the stretcher. Time, Ray.
Well, yeah, both guys throwing punches. What can you say? I mean, the punches were still in progress, as referee Cortez stated.
Hey, Joe Cortez has one of the toughest jobs in sports. I'm sure that you yourself have often reflected that refereeing a boxing match is as difficult as umpiring a baseball game or refereeing an NBA championship game. Maybe tougher.
It's argumentative. I mean, no question about it. I mean, both guys, both camps will definitely say their man was victimized, almost so from the Starling camp.
Let's go to Larry Merchant with Marlon Starling.
Marlon, would you explain what happened from your point of view?
Well, I believe I was moving around and my leg got twisted under his, and it's, you know, it snapped, and he hit me on the way down.
You felt that your leg is broken after you were hit?
I don't know, you know. He didn't hit me to put me down.
You felt that you hurt your leg twisting away from him as the bell rang?
Of course.
You heard the bell ring?
Yes.
And then as you twisted away, you said you heard something snap, and then you got hit.
Well, I'm not saying I heard something snap, but you know, I twisted it. But we still could go. You know, there's nothing wrong. I'm all right.
You seem to be dominating him up to that point. The last two rounds, you were in complete control.
I'm still in control.
What are your feelings, though? They've declared the other guy the champion. He is the champion now.
I don't think he's the champion. How could he be the champion? When?
We're protesting and we're bringing suit.
The referee has ruled that the punch was launched.
Count me out? Was out? When did he count?
They did count you
when?
Out.
He did count you out.
He did hit you, and if you don't remember it, that's proof that he hit you. But the dispute is whether he hit you as the bell rang or after the bell rang.
Stopped the fight.
And they stopped the fight because they counted you out and they ruled that you were knocked out.
Do I look knocked out? Do I look like I'm wobbled?
Well, you only have to be knocked out for 10 seconds.
I wasn't knocked out. I wasn't knocked down.
All right. What have your doctor told you? Has he told you that he thinks you have a broken leg? Did they want to take you out?
I didn't talk to the doctor. I can go another round.
Thank you, Marlon. Once again, I want to point out that the handlers of Marlon Starling are going to protest this result. They say they're going to bring suit. I don't know if they have any recourse or not. It seems unlikely. Jim?
All right, Larry, now let me communicate directly with our producers at this moment. New Jersey State Athletic Commission Chairman Larry Hazard is now standing at ringside with an HBO headset on, looking at one of our monitors, and obviously his interest is in seeing a replay of this and attempting to determine in his own mind whether the punch was thrown before the bell sounded. So if we can, I think it might be useful, as you look at Larry Hazard there, to once again replay the final punch and the final sequence in regular speed. Ray Leonard and I will stay out, and let's see if we can give Larry Hazard an idea of what happened at the end of this bout. And now with Larry Hazard looking on the replay. Up there, Just come down here and do me a favor and tell me exactly what you saw.
When the bell rang, the punch was in motion. Man can't stop a punch in midair. When the bell rang, the punch was in motion. That was a clear shot.
All right, there's the word of Larry Hazard. Chairman of
Jim, one of the first rules of a professional fighter, and an especially experienced fighter, is that when the bell does ring, you have your hands up. And here is Marlon Starling, who's had his hands up all during the fight, catching 90% of the punches. And at that exact moment, when he has to have his hands up, for some reason he didn't. Now, he says he was twisting away and he heard something snap. I can't attest to that. But obviously, he was hit with a punch like that, which is not uncommon.
All right, Larry Hazard's got the headset back on and wants to look at it one more time. So let's try it again. No, wrong headset. Wait a minute. Wrong headset. Let's get him an announce headset. Larry, put that one on. All right, one more time in regular motion. Hazard nods his head and says that he believes the punch was in motion as the bell sounded. Well, this one they will talk about for quite some time. Larry just made a point. Ray, I want you to comment on it. The point being that a fighter must protect himself at all times, even when the bell is in the process of sounding or has just sounded. You agree?
Oh, no question about that. I mean, those are rules that you're given in the dressing room. Those are rules that you've grown up with. The fact of the matter was, as I saw it, that the guys were still punching. The punches were in motion. When, at the time of the delivery of Molinari's punch, his head was down and he had delivered that overhand right. I'm sure Stalin's going to protest it, but again, he was in shock at the time. He couldn't express himself.
So what we have seen is a rather bizarre evening of boxing in Atlantic City. Two world welterweight championship fights, and both of them will wind up with strange and memorable endings. Larry Merchant, we came here looking ahead to potential unification somewhere down the road of two-thirds of the welterweight championship. One-third of it still belongs to Lloyd Hunnigan. One-third of it now belongs to Tomas Molinares of Colombia. Simon Brown was here to watch what happened. Your final thoughts on what took place here tonight in Atlantic City.
Well, I've often called boxing the theater of the unexpected, but this time we took it to a ridiculous end. Among the other ironies of this second fight is the fact that Marlon Starling has never been knocked down, much less out. And here, in a fight that he's clearly beginning to dominate, and just sort of counting up the punches, he gets caught. And, of course, that's one of the things that makes boxing the dramatic sport it is. You can hit a five-run home run. You can be down 4-0 and come up and hit a five-run home run and win the game. And that's what happened. And the first fight, of course, was another freak incident. So all I can say is, did they call this double trouble, this card? We had double trouble.
More grist for the mill. Before we go away, gentlemen, let's just settle one thing. I don't believe that punch was launched before the bell had sounded. In fact, I think that the punch was launched after the bell had sounded. But all of us are going to have individual opinions about that. Ray, how did you see it?
Well, I thought the punch was in motion. I mean, I thought it was a legitimate punch. It's just unfortunate that Stalin was caught with it.
And do you believe, Larry, that it was launched before the bell?
From what I saw, I would have to go in a room and carefully watch it. But it was so close that, as you said, human error, if there was error, and maybe there wasn't. In any event, he was supposed to protect himself. He had never been knocked down or out. He didn't protect himself. He was knocked out. He himself didn't even know he had been hit, as we heard him say. The theater of the unexpected.
I'll tell you what we're going to do. Before we go away, we're going to take a look at that decisive punch one last time, and this time we are going to attempt to freeze the action at the bell to see where Molinares' hand is. So let's see what that shows us. Okay, we've frozen it at the bell. Was cocked next to his body. Tough call.
Yeah. I thought thought that that clearly showed that he hadn't launched the punch. It was a split second before he was about to. It's understandable that he couldn't stop it, but I don't think there's any doubt that he hadn't started it until after that bell hit.
You, Ray?
The bell had rung, no question about it, but he still was in the process of throwing a punch. It's tough to stop a punch when it's in the motion.
I'll stick with what I said. A human sport, like all of them, subject to human error. I personally believe we saw one tonight.